السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأصلي وأسلم على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين نبينا وحبيبنا وقرة أعيننا محمد بن عبد الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. وقال تعالى في كتابه العزيز بعد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. يسبح لله ما في السماوات وما في الأرض الملك القدوس العزيز الحكيم. صدق الله العظيم. All praise and thanks be to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is our creator, sustainer, nourisher, protector and curer. May the choicest of his blessings and salutations be upon our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family members, his companions and all those who tread upon his path with utmost sincerity until the day of Qiyamah. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, we thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that He has blessed us with an opportunity to continue on this amazing journey with the glorious and beautiful names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So today, inshaAllah ta'ala, we'll be delving into the glorious name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Quddus. The name Al-Quddus. So this name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how many times has it been mentioned in the Noble Quran? It is a name, a glorious name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that has been established in the Quran and the Sunnah. And when we say Sunnah, we're talking about the ahadith of our Master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now as for the Quran, how many times has it been mentioned in the Noble Quran? It has been mentioned twice. It has been mentioned twice in the Quran. Number one, in Surah Al-Hashr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says, هُوَ اللَّهُ, He is Allah. هُوَ اللَّهُ الَّذِي لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُمْ, He is Allah, there is no deity worthy of worship except Him. لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُمْ. هُوَ اللَّهُ الَّذِي لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ الْمَلِكُ الْقُدُّوسُ السَّلَامُ الْمُؤْمِنُ الْمُهَيْمِنُ الْعَزِيزُ الْجَبَّارُ الْمُتَكَبِّرُ سُبْحَانَ اللَّهِ عَمَّا يُشْرِكُونَ. So Surah Al-Hashr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, هُوَ اللَّهُ الَّذِي لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا هُوَ الْمَلِكُ الْقُدُّوسُ. And the second place where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions this name is in Surah Al-Jum'ah, the ayah I recited in the beginning, يُسَبِّحُ لِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ الْمَلِكِ الْقُدُّوسِ الْعَزِيزِ الْحَكِيمِ. These are the two places where Allah the Almighty mentions this name, Al-Quddus. These are the two places in the Noble Quran. Now as for the name, what is its meaning? In the Arabic language, in most of the books of ahadith, in most of the books of fiqh, we have something known, say if there is an Arabic term, we have a definition which stands for the lugh, in the sense we say in Arabic, lughatan and istilahan. Lughatan means the literal translation of it, and istilahan means the technical perspective of it, or the technical term. Say for example, as examples bring about clarity, say if you were to take the term as-salah, As-salah literally means prayer. And when I say prayer, I'm talking about, say, invocation, dua, as-salah. The literal meaning. So when we say as-salah lughatan in Arabic, you would find this in many books of ahadith, many books of fiqh. As you open it up, you have for every term a lughatan meaning and an istilahan. In other words, a literal meaning and a technical term for it. So salah means a dua or prayer. Now what is its shari'i meaning? What is its technical term? A specified set of actions which begin with takbiratul ihram. We say takbiratul ihram, the first takbir. Takbiratul ihram. And this specified set of actions end with the taslim. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. This is the shari'i meaning of as-salah. So every term has a literal meaning and a shari'i meaning. A literal term and a technical or a shari'i perspective, a sharia perspective. So when we say salah, like I said in the beginning, literally it means dua. Now if I were to ask a brother, did you make salatul fajr? The first thing that's going to come to his head is not, did you make a fajr prayer, in the sense, did you make a special fajr dua? No. The first thing that's going to strike his mind is that I'm talking about the two units of salah, basically, the two raka'ah of salah. I'm talking about fajr salah. So that's the shari'i perspective. That's what people have got used to. So even in the word Al-Quddus, the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, lughatan, we say literally, there are two meanings for it. Two meanings for the name Al-Quddus. Al-Quddus comes from its roots, which are Al-Quddus. Al-Quddus in the Arabic language, which means At-Tahara, which means purity. Al-Quddus, two meanings. Meaning number one, Al-Quddus is derived from Al-Quddus, which translates to purity. And also it can be derived from Al-Qadas. We have Al-Quddus and Al-Qadas. Qadas, which translates to a bucket or a pail of water which is used to purify oneself. So once again it's coming into the meaning of purification. A bucket or a pail of water which is used to purify oneself. These are the roots from where this name has been taken from. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Noble Quran, وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفًا. At the instance when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned to the angels that I'm going to create Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, the ayah, the meaning goes along the lines of these words, and place him on this earth. Then what did the malaika say?
قالوا أتجعل فيها من يفسد فيها ويسفك الدماء.
They ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Allah, are you going to place someone who is going to cause corruption, who is going to shed blood on the face of this earth? Now a question could arise, how did the malaika come up with such a thing? This was due to their experience with the jinnat. The jinnat were a creation who lived many thousand years before human beings. And they caused a lot of corruption, mischief. They shed blood on the face of this earth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had to send down armies of angels to contain them and drive them away into far islands, remote islands, and into the seas. So due to that, they were asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala out of respect. They wanted to know why Allah the Almighty, is He going to place someone who a creation that is going to shed blood and cause corruption? And then they go on to say,
وَنَحْنُ نُسَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِكَ وَنُقَدِّسُ لَكَ.
Now the point of me mentioning this ayah is to come to this term, وَنُقَدِّسُ لَكَ, from the same term, Al-Quddus, وَنُقَدِّسُ لَكَ. Ya Allah, are you going to place a creation that is going to cause corruption, that is going to shed blood on the face of this earth, whilst we are there? The malaika are informing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whilst we, the malaika, we are there, nusabbihu, we are there to glorify you, wa nuqaddisu lak. Now the scholars of tafasir, they give meanings for this. Wa nuqaddisu lak, one meaning could be that we would purify ourselves for you, Ya Allah. We are there for you, to glorify you and to purify ourselves for you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He replies, Inni a'lamu ma la ta'lamun. The ayah ends there, that I know that which you all do not know. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I know that which you all do not know. So anyway, the point of me mentioning that ayah is to highlight, wa nuqaddisu lak, from the same root, Al-Quddus, purify oneself. And another meaning that can be given to wa nuqaddisu lak, that we are there to glorify you, Ya Allah, and likewise we are there to eliminate all, in a sense the term tanzih is used here, to eliminate all elements where people would associate, or where the creation of Allah, any type of creation that you would create, Ya Allah, where they would associate partners unto you, the mischief, the corruption, to eliminate all of that, we will do it, Ya Allah. We will do it. وَنُقَدِّسُ لَكَ. So the malaika, they are telling Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala this. Now, as for the second meaning, one meaning as we discussed now, we understand that it is for purity. The second meaning, all of us might have come across this word, بَيْتُ الْمَقْدِسِ. Baytul Maqdis. This also comes from the same root. Yani al-ardu al-muqaddasa. We have a blessed land. Al-muqaddasa, al-maqdis. So what does this translate into? This also translates, before I go into the second meaning, this also translates as purified house of Allah. The purified house of Allah, the purified masjid of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is free from all sins. Now as for the second meaning, it also translates into al-barakah. It translates into blessings. And that's why we say the blessed house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The blessed names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Baytul Maqdis can also be translated as the blessed house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And why scholars mention this meaning, many respected elders and brothers in Islam? Because Allah the Almighty Himself says, سُبْحَانَ الَّذِي أَسْرَى بِعَبْدِهِ لَيْلًا مِنَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ إلى المسجد الأقصى الذي باركنا حوله. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when talking about the night journey of our beloved master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, al-mi'raj and isra, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, سُبْحَانَ الَّذِي أَسْرَى بِعَبْدِهِ لَيْلًا مِنَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ إلى المسجد الأقصى. From masjid al-haram to masjid al-aqصى الذي باركنا حوله. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about masjid al-aqصى and he says, Masjid al-Aqsa, that which we bless its surrounding. الَّذِي بَارَكْنَا حَوْلَ. From the same root, barakah. Blessed land. The masjid and the surrounding lands are blessed. أَرْضُ الْمُقَدَّسَ. So two meanings. Purity, likewise, blessed. Barakah. These are the two meanings that can be given to the name Al-Quddus. Now, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, let's look at what are Salafun al-Salih, the scholars, the Ahlul Ilm, they say about the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Al-Quddus. Imam Bayhaqi rahimahullah, he says that the name Al-Quddus, he says, هو الطاهر من العيوب المنزه عن الأولاد والأنداد. That the name Al-Quddus, هو الطاهر. That name, that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is free. He is completely free من العيوب المنزه from all types of defects. You name a defect, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is free from it. Allah is complete in His perfection. And the best of qualities are attributed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He is free from all defects. عن الأولاد. And He is also free from children. قُلْ هُوَ اللَّهُ أَحَدٌ اللَّهُ الصَّمَدُ لَمْ يَلِدْ وَلَمْ يُولَدْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He does not give birth, nor was He begotten. So no children. وَالْأَنْدَاد. Likewise, there are no partners unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You cannot associate anything to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He's free, free from all of that. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. There is nothing, nothing similar to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Imam Ibn Kathir and Imam Ash-Shawkani rahimahumallah, they both say two statements which are similar to this. Al-Munazzah anil naqa'is al-mawsuf bi sifat al-kamal. Allahu Akbar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is free. Free from all kinds of defects that come to a human being's mind. Say for example, the attribute of speech is confirmed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Kalam. This confirmed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now our weak mind could come up with something saying, now if I were to speak, I need a mouth, I need a tongue, I need a throat to basically articulate the words. So we would think that, okay, if speech has been confirmed for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so He also might need all of these parts to communicate. No, Allah. No, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. Whatever comes to our minds, our weak minds, we cannot perceive. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala confirms the attribute of speech to Him. He can. He has it. But not the way we think. Not the way we think. When you talk about the wajh of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when I say the word face, the first thing that comes to all of our minds, two eyes, a nose and a mouth. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. There is nothing similar to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is nothing. Many sects in Islam went astray because they started thinking of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, saying the face of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is similar to our faces. The hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala are similar to our hands. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, الرحمن على العرش استوى. Allah the Almighty ascended over His throne. And they say, okay, if a person were to ascend over something, say if I were to ascend this member, I would have to ascend like this. So, you know, a doubt could come perhaps, did Allah the Almighty ascend as such? No. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ. Allah says He ascended, we accept that. How did He ascend? We do not know, nor do we ask about it. Because asking about it is a bid'ah. It will make you go astray. We confirm what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, that He ascended. We confirm that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about His wajah. We confirm that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about His hand. We confirm all of that. But how, what shape, in what way is it? All of those questions are not for us, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. So this is what Imam Ibn Kathir and Imam Al-Shawkani rahimahumullah, they say. Now coming back to Al-Quddus, this particular name, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, is in its mubalagha sense. Now what do I mean by that? You have something in English known as hyperbole. Hyperbole. It means to exaggerate about something in a manner that it is not going to happen. Like say for example, if I were to say, you know brother, I'll wait an eternity for you. I will wait an eternity for you. Now is that possible? Am I immortal? Can I wait for an eternity? I can't. So it's an exaggeration, but to give him the idea that I'll wait for however long you want me to wait. But I cannot wait for an eternity. Now in terms of Al-Quddus, it is magnified indeed. When we say purity, when we say Al-Quddus, in that form, in that scale, we are saying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most pure. Is the most pure. We are magnifying it in a sense which is actual. We aren't exaggerating in a false manner as how hyperboles work. We aren't exaggerating in a false manner. It is true. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is extremely pure. Our words cannot describe that purity. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Jalla Jalalu, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our words cannot describe the purity of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is how pure Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. Al-Quddus. This is the translation of Al-Quddus. My words, however eloquent a scholar be, whatever the array of words he uses, he cannot do justice to translate the name of Allah Al-Quddus. That is how pure Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. In regard to the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it is likewise pure, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. Now, what is the point of delving into the science of the glorious names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What is the point of knowing that Allah the Almighty is pure? It is so that we too become pure. We too inculcate that quality. We talk about Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim. We have to bring in mercy. We talk about Al-Ghafoor. We have to become forgiving. Likewise, Al-Quddus, we're talking about purity. We need to make ourselves pure, spiritually and physically. Islam is a religion. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reported to have said, At-tuhuru shatrul iman. Allahu Akbar. Purity is half of iman. Half of iman. Half of iman. So being pure physically and spiritually is mandatory in our religion, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. People should not think, oh, this brother, he has grown a huge beard. He does not maintain it. He thinks. These are things that can never be attributed to a Muslim. We have to be the most smart, the most clean of individuals. Because this is what our deen, this is what Islam demands of us. And this is what Allah the Almighty demands of us.
Now in Islam, there are three impurities. We have something known as najis, something known as hadath, and something known as az-zunub. Three types of impurities: hadath, najis, and az-zunub. Najis, we all know, impurities. You take the stool or the droppings of animals, all of these are known as najis, impurities. We cannot come into contact with any type of an impurity. Our own excretions, our own things that we emit from our body, all of that are known as najis. We cannot come into contact with that. If we do, we have to purify ourselves. We know that. Likewise, something known as hadas. What is hadas? Hadas is a ritual impurity. Say if an individual were to break his ablution, he hasn't become impure by himself. He has just broken his ablution. But he is out of the state of ablution. So he is known as being under a minor impurity. A hadath al-asghar. This is a ritual impurity. You cannot, it's not tangible. You cannot see the najis. Now say a dropping of an animal, you can see it. It's in front of you. The pig, you can see it in front of you. Calf, dog, you can see it in front of you. Najis, you can see it. But as for hadath, ritual impurities, you cannot see them in front of you. But you fall under a state of ritual impurity. And finally, az-zunub, sin. Sins are also a type of an impurity that dirties our heart, that hardens our heart. So three types of impurities. Now as for najis, you know, if it strikes your body or your dress, perhaps you can wash it away and you purify yourself. Say you yourself, you went and relieved yourself. Now you are impure, likewise you are under hadas. You need to make ablution. So two things together. Now both of this can be coupled, and you go and make ablution, you purify yourself and make ablution, you come out of the impurity of najis, likewise the impurity of hadas. Both of it is, you know, vanquished away. Now as for az-zunub, how do we purify ourselves from az-zunub? My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, it is through connecting to Al-Quddus, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is through connecting to Al-Quddus, staying away from sin. We'll come to that. Now these three, or the first two, najis and hadas, say for example, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, this is just to highlight what a pure deen we have. Just say an individual is impure, he has got some najis on his body, likewise he is under a hadas. He goes and bathes in the ocean for 3 hours. 3 hours in the ocean. He bathed for 3 hours. Okay, perhaps the najis, the impurity on his body would have been cleaned away. 3 hours. He might have become like a prune in the ocean. 3 hours. 3 hours. But would he become ritually pure? For 3 hours he bathes in the ocean with no intention of ablution. Will he become ritually pure? Will the hadath al-asghar, will the minor ritual impurity be moved away from him? No. But on the other hand, instead of bathing for 3 hours, if he goes and takes half a liter of water, makes intention and performs ablution, he becomes pure for salah. He becomes pure for salah. But on the other hand, he bathes for 3 hours in the ocean without intention, he still cannot make salah. He is impure. He is impure. This is how hadas works, and this is how our deen works, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. When we talk about purity in regard to hadas, intention is important. The tarteeb of the wudu is important. We have to follow the commandments of our master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the teachings of our master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the commandments of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if we want to perfectly follow the deen. Now the worst type of impurity, finally, is kufr and shirk. The worst type of impurity, which I did not attach, it actually breaks off from az-zunub. It is a different level. Kufr and shirk. Kufr is to reject Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Shirk, associate partners unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all. These two impurities, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, nothing can purify it, not even the fire of Jahannam, not even the inferno of Jahannam can purify an individual from kufr and shirk. Not even the blazing fire of Jahannam. nothing other than the only thing that can purify an individual from the impurities of kufr and shirk is him turning to Al-Quddus, Allah the Almighty, who is the most pure. Only He can purify that individual from kufr and shirk. For any other zunub, say you have brought in iman, you committed a sin, you committed a murder, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all. You committed zina, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all. If you were to be put in the fire of Jahannam, someday you will be purified and you will come out. Allah save us all. Don't take it easy. Don't take it easy. It's not a vacation in Jahannam. Jahannam will purify you someday. But kufr and shirk are two traits, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. Nothing can purify other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is Al-Quddus. This is the worst type of impurity, kufr and shirk. My dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, just two examples. One in regard to ihram. Has this question ever crossed your mind that when the minute an individual ties ihram, you know what is ihram, just before you go on a umrah or hajj, the minute you tie on your ihram, certain things become, why is it known as ihram? It comes from the word haram, takbiratul ihram, haram. So basically when you put on your ihram, those things that were permissible before you went into ihram became haram upon you. You can't cut your nails, you can't hunt, you can't wear perfume, or coming to that. Did the question ever cross your mind as to why the minute you put on your ihram, why can you not put perfume? Why can't you apply perfume? Perfume is something pure. You say itr, for example. Itr, fragrance, is something pure. Why can't you apply it? Why is there an ihram? The reason being, scholars mentioned, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, that when we turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the state of ihram, we go to Him pure of all of these things of dunya. Of all of these things of dunya. Because even a fragrance, even a itr, is used to cover perhaps the bad odor from your body. It is used. It is something fake which is used to cover your natural odor. Right? So the minute you enter into ihram, you're basically shunning everything away from this dunya. Look at what you're wearing. Unstitched garments. You're going in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ya Quddus, Ya Allah, I have come, labbaik, in front of you, leaving all of this behind. This dunya is nothing to me. Look at Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam. The minute Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded him to go, leave his wife and his son in a barren desert. Today is Makkah. Barren desert. Go and leave your newly born son and your wife there. He immediately complied. He passed the test with flying colors. He goes and leaves his son and his wife in a barren desert. After some time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, now the child has become the apple of his eye. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands him, Ya Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam, sacrifice him. Sacrifice him. Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam did not question his maker. He did not question Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, what is the logic behind me sacrificing my own son? Or what are you going to gain from me sacrificing my son? Nay, he immediately went, complied to the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Father and son both complied. Both of them passed the test with flying colors. And this is how, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam became the Khalil of Allah, the friend of Allah. He shunned everything away from this dunya. The ultimate love, the love for Allah. The love for Allah. If you love Allah, you love your master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you adopt his life as your life. This is the circle of love. And this is basically what ihram is all about. Purifying yourself physically and spiritually from this dunya completely. Turning to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, pure. And finally, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, beware of spiritual punctures that lead to a spiritual death. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us all. Tomorrow, if you were to hear that so and so has passed away, it is sad. It is heartbreaking if it is somebody close to us. But at the end of the day, we are on a journey. We are on a journey. We haven't come here to live forever. This is a transitory stage. So we know, whether it be our father, our mother, our sister, our brother, our wife, our children, whoever it may be, they have crossed over to the next stage, we are coming behind. That is all. They have crossed over, we are coming behind. I'm talking about real death. But as for a spiritual death, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, spiritual punctures gradually lead to a spiritual death. If an individual were to die spiritually, that is the end. That is the end. If his heart were to blacken, die, grow hard as stone, if his soul were to die, then there is nothing more remaining for him, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, because he is going to lose in this world as well as the hereafter. What does our Master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say? He says in a hadith, the hadith goes along the lines of these words, the difference between an individual who remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and an individual who does not remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Gatherings like this, we are remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are studying the glorious names and attributes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to know Him better, to love Him better. We make dhikr, the remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We recite the Quran, remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We seek knowledge, remembrance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But an individual who does not do any of that, the difference between him and the one who does is like the living and the dead. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is highlighting that if you do not remember your maker, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will spiritually die. If a person were to not remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he's not going to fall dead right in front of us. But spiritual death is what our Master sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is highlighting in the hadith. And that death is the worst type of death, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam. And the only way to save ourselves from that, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, najasa, you clean yourself using water. Najasa, you clean yourself using water. Your heart, and we're talking all of this from purity because Al-Quddus means purity. You clean yourself from najasa using water. You clean your heart, if it is blackened by sins, by the impurity of sins, with your tears, Allahu Akbar. With your tears. You purify your heart with your tears. You turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in tawbah. You wake up in the last third of the night and you turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in tawbah. Allah is waiting. It is never too late. As long as the sun, before the sun rises from the west, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, the door of tawbah is wide open. Our beloved maker is waiting for us. Whatever the sin it may be, turn to him sincerely. Turn to him in sincere tawbah, Allah the Almighty will accept you. But if the sun rises from the west, the door of tawbah will be slammed shut. And at that moment, my dear respected elders and brothers in Islam, even if we were to cry tears of blood, not the salty tears that are coming now, tears of blood, even if we were to cry tears of blood, the door of tawbah will never be open for anybody. So it's never too late, it's never too late. We can purify our hearts with our tears, with our tears. And finally our soul can be purified with love. And what love am I talking about? The love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the love for our Master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Pure love, free of all innovation, bringing his life as our life. We will be successful in this world as well as the hereafter. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of our sins. May Allah the Almighty fill our hearts with pure love for Allah the Almighty and His and our beloved Master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And may He unite us in the gardens of Jannah just as how He united us tonight. Wa akhir da'wa ya'ni alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Jazakum Allah khair.